I want to get your raw thoughts on earnings, and we'll split it up into a couple discussions. We'll start with revenue growth and or lack of revenue growth and GAAP profitability. So GAAP profits, I think we all knew we were going to get. We got the GAAP profits, and management kept stressing on the earnings call to trust them that by November they will be eligible for S&P 500 inclusion. So it's kind of a given that they want to get to GAAP profitability. In order to get to GAAP profitability, they have to put $1 billion into T-bonds and get $11 million of net interest income. So that pushed them over the edge. And then on top of that, revenue growth was 13% year over year, much lower than management's guidance of 30% or previous guidance a year and a half ago for a 30% CAGR year over year at $533 million. What are your raw thoughts on the GAAP profitability and the revenue growth? And are you concerned at all about the lack of revenue growth that a lot of us were expecting?
Yeah, so a little disappointed overall. I mean, you know, EPS I thought was always a wild card, you know, that's unpredictable at this given moment. So that I never had a strong feeling about, but I was expecting some sort of beat in terms of the revenue line item, you know, for the company. To see them only come in line was definitely disappointing. Like, they didn't have to tear it up. This didn't have to be some insane quarter where they grew, you know, 25% on a year-over-year basis or something like that. But I just expected something, like $5 million beat, like something. But just to come straight in line was kind of like, ah, oh, man. And then, obviously, we got the guide. The guide slightly ahead of, you know, kind of what was expectations were. But even that was kind of like, ah, you know, there's kind of been a feeling around Palantir, you know, based upon kind of the way Carp's been talking and whatnot, that we're going to get back to those, you know, mega growth levels, which, you know, if you're really talking about big time growth, you're talking 20 to 30% type revenue growth. And there's kind of been that feeling about we might get back there. We might get back there. And then with the you know, the inline numbers, and then obviously with the guidance where it is, it's kind of like, oh, dang, maybe we're not going to get back there. And so, yeah, for me, I was a little, I don't want to say like let down. It was just kind of like, oh, that's not a very exciting earnings. There's nothing here that's kind of like game changing. So that, because you kind of thought maybe there could be that NVIDIA type moment,
yeah,
where they're just going to, you know, say some sort of guidance number that you're just like, whoa, they're really talking about that. Or maybe Carp leading on, like, we're going to get back to 30% type growth based upon how many, you know, calls he's talking about there, in, you know, incoming and whatnot. And to just kind of hear like, it's not there right now. That was kind of a little disappointing. So, and I think that's put a damper on the stock. And I think it's taken a lot of the short-term momentum out of the stock, obviously, because a lot of people are looking at it and like, well, you know, the Palantir story is just rolling on. Yeah, they still got S&P 500 inclusion likely coming, but this does not sound like it's a NVIDIA type story where we're going to get mega growth anytime soon. And so, yeah, just kind of like, that's kind of where I feel things are at, which is, by the way, I don't think it's a bad thing. Because, I mean, there was so much momentum. So, you know, you get a lot of silliness that starts to come into the stock when it has the sort of move it had. You know, we were approaching a 200% gain on the stock, I think, year to date. And a lot of people started getting attracted to the stock that they don't even really care about Palantir. It's just like little short-term money. Like, you know, let's try to play this for the next week. Let's play this for the next month. This is the swing right now. And you start attracting some of the wrong type of people to your shareholder base. And it kind of moves from folks that were very long-term focused, that were buying the dip last year as the stock got, you know, obviously cremated, and, you know, we're buying it this year when it was obviously a lot cheaper, to, you know, then people are just, it's the momentum play. And so anyways, I think it's a healthier thing long-term, but I would love to see them get back to, you know, 20 to 30% type growth rates is where I think this company should be at. And I hope they're able to get there at least in 2024, but it just doesn't sound like it's probably happening this year.
Did you think
your take, by the way?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you 100%. I expected Q2 to come in line with guidance, because for SaaS companies, traditionally Q2 is really tough, especially in this macro environment. So I hopefully Q3, Q4 will be better. But even then, I think this year is not going to be the 30, 40% year we're looking for, that NVIDIA quarter. I think it will be 2024, 2025, probably more so 2025. And we'll talk about why in the context of AIP. But yeah, I kind of expected this quarter to be flat. Now, I thought Wall Street would tank it even worse than it's been tanked. And honestly, I think the decline, the 20% decline over the past 2 days is really more so because of Moody's being moody. And then what's the other thing that happened today? Something happened today. Oh, the CPI level. We all know it's probably going to go up a little bit tomorrow. And so as a result of that, the market's kind of preparing. So I think that on top of, it's kind of like PayPal and Robinhood reporting the day that Fitch decided to be a a bitch, to be honest. That kind of messed up everything. I think that's a little bit affecting Palantir. Did you think at $20 it was overvalued?
I wouldn't say overvalued, but I thought it was kind of in that territory of like, you know, let's just chill for now. Let's just hold this through. Let's see how this comes out. Because when you're dealing with a company that could be potentially at some next, you know, major stairway of growth, it's hard to say it's overvalued or undervalued at that moment. When you have an NVIDIA come in, say, you know, we were thinking 6% growth, we're growing 60%. And then when you have Palantir talking about, you know, we're getting as many calls in a month that we used to get in a year, when you're hearing these sorts of things, you're kind of like, maybe this is actually still undervalued. But so for me, it's kind of just been a hold recently. I might get out there as an active buyer again as soon as maybe potentially Friday in regards to Palantir. But yeah, so, you know, and I think the other big damper really on the quarter that's not talked about enough is really Karp on the call, mm-hmm. you know, basically stating that AIP, you know, we're going to figure out a way to monetize that. And just Wall Street doesn't like to hear that because Wall Street reads that as, are we incompetent? Like, how do you guys not have a plan here? Right. That's just kind of like the moment I heard that, I was like, oh no, like Karp, what are you talking about here, man? Like, you know, Wall Street does not want to hear that. And we finally have started to build some Wall Street like momentum around the stock. And then to come in and have that specific sentence, it just kind of showed me that like Karp still has to learn this game of Wall Street and what you can say and what you can't say, which is a whole like game in itself. And it, you know, there's a lot of CEOs that are really good at this game. I think Tim Cook's one of the best. I call him the Apple pumper. Like, he's so good on those conference calls of just like, you know, even Apple has had declining revenue several quarters in a row. And yet that stock was pushing an all-time high just a couple weeks ago.
Yep.
And, you know, Tim Cook just knows how to, you know, run the narrative around Apple and things like that. You know, Karp still, I think, has to learn that game. I think he's slowly learning, but you know, it's a game you got to learn for a while. And so, but you know, that was kind of one of those moments where it's like, wait, I thought AIP was going to be this massive new growth factor. And now they're trying to figure out how they're going to monetize it. Maybe it's not a big growth factor. And so anyways, you know, I think that's another just kind of damper on the stock that's going on here in the short term that hopefully should, you know, abate eventually, but it is what it is right now. Did you read anything into that sentence or what yeah. kind of your thoughts?
I mean, I also wanted to talk to you about that. I think in the context of AIP, so in the shareholder letter, and this was not in the deck, which was really interesting. You kind of really got to be a retail investor and read through the lines here. They said they have 100 organizations using AIP, which was like, okay, cool. And you got 300 additional enterprises in the pipeline to get onboarded to AIP. So what I got is that there are 400 potential customers, 100 that are like 80% of the way there to paying you, and 300 that are probably 40% of the way to even thinking of paying you that are in the pipeline for AIP. And to me, as a shareholder, I'm like, that's really interesting. And this is the kind of conversation I wanted to get into with you about this is, do you think this is the potential quarter and maybe even the rest of the year where we are going to see maybe 16%, 15% revenue growth for the year with the hopes that AIP is this Trojan horse that they're just stacking clients on top of in the pipeline, not getting a single dime from them, and basically doing what Karp said he was going to do at AIP conference. What did he say he was going to do? He said, we're going to educate people about the problem. We're going to let them know what generative AI really is, because we've been working on building this stuff for the past 20 years. So we're the exact ones to do it. And then we're going to give them our product for free. They're going to use it. They're going to see how valuable it is. And then we're going to have all the pricing power in terms of being able to charge them for it. I mean, if all 400 of those clients, let's say, pay $2 million a year, that's $800 million in annual recurring revenue. And a client like BP or Pepsi or Coca-Cola, they're going to pay a lot more than $2 million to use AIP. So do you think that is something shareholders should take into account, the sacrificing of short-term revenue growth in order to have that massive NVIDIA quarter eventually, if you can just keep getting these clients into AIP and then locking them in to Palantir's ecosystem?
Yeah, I think it's a potential, and it's one that I wasn't even strongly considering before, obviously, the most recent earnings here. And I don't know if you got to see, somebody posted this tweet today, and it showed Karp with a Trojan horse.
Oh, it did?
Yeah, inside the Trojan horse is like Apollo, Gotham, you know, Foundry. And in AIP, or excuse me, AIP is the, you know, the actual horse. And so it kind of like leading on, like AIP is the thing to get all this interest so they can ultimately sell their high-end products. And it's like, this is our attention grabber. This is almost like, like a grocery store has a loss leader, you know, which is usually like milk and eggs and stuff they'll put on sale or whatever, right? And for Palantir, it's like AIP is this thing that gets everybody excited talking about us, wanting to talk with us, and then we can go in and we can sell our main product. So that's something that I think is I'm considering. It's just the problem with that is it's hard to really model numbers, I feel like. I think it's hard, really difficult to model numbers around something of like, well, what could we get for this product over time? You know, what sort of growth rates are we talking about if this is a standalone product? So I don't know, man, that's where I'm even having trouble trying to figure out, you know, in terms of that. And I'd love to hear if you have more perspective and opinion, because I know there's a gentleman you had on your channel recently. I actually reacted to it on the reaction channel. I think his name was Arnie, right?
Yep.
And he had this kind of perspective of don't take as much revenue up front, you know, let's just continue to build customers using Palantir, and then we'll be able to make money down the road. But I'd love to kind of hear your perspective. If you think that's, you know, a route Palantir should go, is just focus on customer growth and focus on money down the road, or kind of what you think about that.
Yeah, I think it's the only route they can take, to be honest, because in this market, and I think it's not just them, same with Snowflake and Databricks and some of these other companies, even Microsoft to an extent, it's really hard to get people to pay for generative AI platform/products right now. Eventually they will. Eventually every enterprise knows that they're going to need to be able to spend. But with 5% interest rates, I don't think they're going to be able to get, you know, one of the largest oil and gas companies that they have as a client for the past 10 years, BP, to start dishing out, you know, 10, 15 million bucks for AIP yet. I think they got to use it for 12 months before they really decide that it's worth implementing. And a company like BP that bought 1% of Palantir for 400 million bucks back in 2021 probably knows how valuable it could be. But even then, you're not going to close them within 10 weeks of rolling it out. And that's what I thought the most interesting thing was, is like the product's been out for 10 weeks. It's been out for 10 weeks. It has 5,000 users. It's growing 50% month over month in terms of the users in the enterprises using them. And in 10 weeks, you have 400 leads that are actually getting ready to develop the product. And so in 10 months, what does that look like? Does that look like 600, 700, 800, 900? Do you become the industry standard for AI platforms? Probably not. Probably it's going to be very difficult to compete with the likes of Microsoft's in the world. But if they do become somewhat of an industry standard or a big player there because they didn't suck up all the money immediately and kind of just let it happen, which is what they did with Foundry for the past 10 years, then maybe that is the potential. And I think all of us as shareholders basically have to accept that, because we can't ask them to show revenue growth immediately, because it's just not going to happen, especially if you try selling AIP to like a defense agency. Like, it's going to take some time before AIP for defense, which is one of the other products they have, materializes. So I think, yeah, we kind of got to deal with it and hope it plays out over the long term.
And that's where we get into this kind of divergence between like the retail shareholder base and like the Wall Street shareholder base, right? Because retail might be willing to take that kind of what's called gamble on, we think this is going to add up to a lot. Whereas Wall Street's like, well, no, show me the data and numbers today. Wait, you're not going to make any money from this anytime soon, or potentially, you know, a year down the road, 2 years, and we don't know how much money. Count us out for now. Versus an NVIDIA is a very easy buy for Wall Street, because they can say, here's the numbers. We're going to grow revenue 60%. Here's just, you know, here's what it's going to add up to on the bottom line, or margins. And Wall Street can get around their heads around that and run the financials and say, okay, boom, let's buy it. You know, a Palantir is kind of a little more of a guessing game, and a little bit more of, you got to play with the numbers. And so, yeah, that's it. That's, yeah, it's intriguing.